So who's the next speaker, Alicia?
So next up is Stefano Tempesta, and he's here to talk to us about the HoloLens. So
Virtual eye vision, I've heard. So that connects nicely together with the stuff that Satya talked before in the previous section, giving actually people who are blind a sort of an eye vision. I'm curious. So yeah, show us what you've got to share.
Thank you. And look, it really does connect really well with what Sadia said. I'll give another angle. Is the cloud angle. Sadia said a very important thing. The cost of cloud can skyrocket if it's not under control, and especially if you use it for training or using GPUs and these sort of things. Obviously, there are ways around it to optimize cost and performance at the same time. But what I want to show you now is a combination of hardware, HoloLens, but not only, as we will see towards the end, spoiler, and also the possibility to access cloud services that are hosted in Azure that are completely on a serverless platform that run as opposite to the edge. So for the audience here today, it's the great opportunity to hear both opportunities. You build at the edge, you build in the cloud, and then it's up to you. You really choose what is more convenient according to your specific needs and your business model. So let me go and share my screen. I have a few slides, and then I want to show you also something in action. This is a technology, not that is meant to describe world and people around the visually impaired. I invite you to watch this video for a little moment.
All the technology of virtual reality and augmented reality is about acquiring the information about what's out there in the scene and then converting it to other uses. All these things are coming together largely as a result of consumer technology, not because someone wanted to build a device for the blind. And we're just riding that wave and combining these different devices and concepts to make a new thing that never existed before.
The HoloLens creates a 3D mesh of the physical space to overlay virtual information on top of physical space. What we did is to try to take advantage of that, but overlay sound or auditory objects on top of physical scenes.
Imagine you are in a world where all the objects around you have voices. When you first walk into a new space, you can simply have the objects call themselves out one at a time from left to right.
Floor lamp, laptop, picture.
And then you can switch to spotlight mode, for example, and point your head towards different objects in the scene. They get activated and speak their names to you. It tries to communicate the visual world at the cognitive level, at the level of language, at the level of understanding.
Navigation started. Follow me. Follow me.
Essentially, we invented this virtual guide. It always stays a few steps ahead of the user. It calls out, follow me, up two flights of stairs, around a few corners, a long stretch of corridor, and then a final turn into my office.
That was pretty cool.
We have 7 blind subjects, and they all managed to do the task to my second floor office the first round.
It was very gratifying to see that the blind person could come to the lab, put on our device, and make their way through the building without further assistance. The sky's the limit for what kind of functionalities you want to build into a device like that, because it's essentially a software problem. We'd like to see this device used and offered at the entrance of large spaces, more or less the way you would adopt an audio guide when you walk into a museum. Right? Plug the headphones in and off you go.
Well, yes, this is a great use of technology. The combination of the HoloLens device, the combination of some services that I will show you in a moment. So how about we dig inside the technology and see how something like this can be built in the Azure platform. Now, if you were wondering, this is an experience done by Caltech. Yes, that's exactly the University of Sheldon Cooper. All right, HoloLens. HoloLens is an untethered device. It means that it can run completely on its own without requiring connectivity, without requiring being plugged, and without being connected wired or wireless to any other device like a laptop or a mobile phone. It has cameras, it has speakers, it has sensors, and it is indeed a little computer in its way. It has a GPU, it has a holographic processing unit, storage, and different ways of connecting to the outside world. As I briefly mentioned before, it's not that lightweight. So, wearing it for a long time is probably not the best experience you can have. And there is development in this space, which I will mention towards the end. And also the duration of the battery probably is not fantastic. So you can really use it comfortably for a couple of hours. After that, you will probably want to take a break. And as being a computer in its own, it runs a special version of a Windows operating system for holographic functionality, Edge as a browser, and a few other apps in the Dynamics 365 for remote assistance to enable technicians of the field to operate with a subject matter expert back in the office to assist over machineries and so on. As Cortana for voice recognition and a few other things. So let's say, okay, I want to build an app for HoloLens. Well, at a very high level, the way an app for HoloLens works is you have to consider it as you would consider any other computer to connect to, as any other device. So you build the holographic app that connect the device to some services that will process all this flow of information that you retrieve, all this data, this telemetry data. You've seen in the video before that there is a scanning of the environment around, and as we will see in a moment, there are capabilities around detecting faces, detecting people, identifying these people as well. So working against a database of celebrities and recognize these celebrities by their face, or pre-training a model of your friends and family and colleagues, and using face detection and identification as well. Now, all this is possible because of some services that we use. And today I want to speak to a couple of services. They are called Azure Cognitive Services. They are is a serverless platform completely hosted in the Azure cloud, with the potential also to run at the edge. But the power of it is that all these services are all machine learning power. They are exposed as a REST API in the cloud, in the Azure cloud. So you don't have to provision any infrastructure for it. You just have to subscribe and start using it. And the good news is that you can start using for free. So there is a free tier that allows you to do a number of calls to the service without paying a single dollar. And still, but despite being strongly powered by machine learning, you're not required to be a data scientist or data engineer at all. These are REST API. They hide the complexity of it, and then you have the possibility to consume it from any device, from any application. I'll show you a few in a moment. So, for example, computer vision is probably one of the largest of these APIs, can do a detection of object, can do detection of faces, form, ink recognition. And as you can imagine, being a sort of a serverless platform, all these models, you know, with the images of any type, they've been pre-trained by Microsoft engineers who have spent uncountable number of hours to upload thousands and thousands of images and labeling all these images. Now, this is great because you can use this computer vision capability straight away without going through the training process. So here, the cloud doesn't cost you a cent or so because you don't have to provision GPUs and do any sort of training. It's already been done for you. But still, you have the possibility with custom vision to customize the object detection using your own model. So you can increase the accuracy of your computer vision capability by bringing your own data set. Now, face detection is the one that I want to focus a bit today. You know, as an API to detect and identify people, emotions and attributes. And rather than showing this in a still image, how about we go in the browser and super simple, just have to search for Azure Cognitive Services. It will end up on this page here where you can see all the different services that are available. Decision, language, speech, vision in the one that I'm after, okay? And all the different services are available in here. So click on face and you will have the possibility to understand how that works. Let me just switch here so we can get more attributes. And as you can see, there is an object here, a JSON object, which is the response of the API that identifies the rectangle of the face or where the face is inside the picture, and some attributes in here. So I have a little simulator of the app that shows exactly this in action, which I'm going to show you in a moment. So let me open it. is a simulator of all the different cognitive services. Okay, so we'll focus on face for today. And as you can see, there are some celebrities in there that are already been pre-classified. And when I pick one of these, I'm doing a call to this API, which is super simple. It's just a HTTP call to a REST endpoint. And I get back that JSON object, which detects both images, so both face within an image, and the coordinates of image one and image two. And as you can see, all the different attributes, gender, estimate age, whether they're smiling, whether they're wearing glasses, any other face attributes. I guess for the men, we should get some values in here, as you can see, and emotions. All these values are between 0 and 1, no? Where 0 means not detected at all, and 1, happy family, happy couple that have been detected. And this obviously works, if you upload a picture, if you take another picture. So how about that? Now I need to stop my own video, otherwise there is a conflict of camera, and then I can take it here. It's gonna be me. Hello there, how about we do that face? All right, and then confirm, send it to the API. It will come up here, face detected, and again, gender, age, thank you, very generous, reading glasses, and a few other attributes. What am I? Oh, it came out as a neutral. Okay, I didn't do my angry face too much well this morning for me. All right, then the other thing you can do is that you can also detect a face, no? So you can actually see who is in the picture. Now, it's not gonna work with me. I'm not a celebrity, so I'm not in the database of VIPs yet. I'm working on it, but we can do something like that. So I can invite here Harry, which is sitting next to me, to take a picture. Harry, do you mind taking a picture for me? Here we go. Harry's coming. Okay, so send the picture to the API. Thank you, Harry. That was generous of you. Face detected. It's still the same guy in here. So if we find a match, now the second part of the API is to detect, and boom, it came out here in red. that the picture where the that person has been detected. Okay, so that's the way it works. Obviously, if I had a custom model, I can upload pictures of my family, friends, pets. Why not? It doesn't work only with people. It works with any kind of object, as long as they are labeled, and then it will detect and recognize. So this is the foundation. This is what we will do now to start building this application, an application that identifies the world around you and detect people, if possible, identify these people, describe how they look like, what they're doing, and then translate this into a voice command. And this is the second part of it, in voice instructions, I mean. And this is the second part of it, is using the speech API, which has, again, different flavor, speech to text, text to speech, speech translation, and speaker recognition. So recognize the voice of a person and identify that person. So from the tone of voice, it will be able to say, hey, this is John, this is Mary. And again, this has to work against a preloaded database of voices that has been trained. And you can personalize this with your own family and friends and colleagues and so on. So in the specific technology that I'm after now is a text-to-speech, because all the data that has been detected by the vision, the computer vision technology, is translated into a text, and this text now has to be voiced to the visually impaired people that are using the device. And the way it works, again, there is something in there that we can test immediately. So let me go back to my cognitive services, go to speech. This is going to be text to speech. And we can test this directly in the browser here. So you see I have different voices that I can pick from Arabic all the way to Tamil, and different accent as well. I can pick Australian English. It defaulted to this because, as I mentioned, I'm based in Australia, but there are also different other flavors. So how about we take English US, different voices, female and male voice, style of the voice, you want something more cheerful, something more professional, and then you can also tune the speed and the pitch. So we can say, hello everybody, welcome to the global AI community, all right? And just listen.
Hello everybody, welcome to the global AI community.
And obviously, different accent will produce different voice, different intonation. And if you want to do the chipmunk effect, just tune up on the pitch.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the global AI community.
And you can have fun as much as you want, okay? So this is all available in there. You can start completely for free. You start paying for the services after a significant volume of data. And this is great to enable developers without provisioning any infrastructure, without uploading any models, without doing any training. You just get started and focus on building your application rather than the AI part of it, which may not be accessible to everybody. So, too much. In summary, in case you were wondering, this text-to-speech is able to synthesize speech into live, into speakers, or into an audio file, or into a memory stream. So the memory stream it will be useful when connecting to a device. So you can the API can synthesize the speech, then you store it in memory, and then send this stream to the device, to whatever speakers, HoloLens you're using. It can even do long asynchronous audios, and it will work completely asynchronously. So then you just render the video over 10 minutes typically, and then get back when it's done and saved. as a support for standard neural voices, so voices that improve and learn over time, support for over 45 languages, different voice, male and female, and also different other flavors. There is an SDK, a software development kit, for a few programming languages. So that means that you don't have to code directly the API. So you don't have to do an HTTP request. What you can do is a single call to two lines of code. Actually, you know what? I can show you here because I have the project open in front of me, which is gonna be somewhere like this is speech. This is text to speech. So I'll just show you very briefly how that looks like. You create a speech config here. This is in C#. That's my preferred programming language. And then speak to the speaker, audio config, speech synthesizer, speaks to text, speech text. That's it. All, this is all you have to do to render your text directly to your, the default speaker. So it's super simple by using the SDK. So it makes very, very accessible. And it also supports SSML, that's Speech Synthesis Markup Language, which is a XML type of language where you can define the tone of voice, some breaks, a sequence of sentences. So make it more and more natural. It comes out actually pretty natural. It doesn't sound as a robotic voice at all. There is a massive development in this space. All right, so before I take a few questions, I invite you to pay attention again for another couple of minutes on this video, where we have Satya Nadella, CEO of Microsoft, inviting an engineer at Microsoft to showcase an enhancement to this technology, which goes beyond the limitation of the HoloLens and use these cognitive services in more advanced way with everything that I show you so far, but bundled into one real application that does face recognition, people recognition, object detection, and text-to-speech synthesis.
Developer truly inspired me this last year, very close to home for us at Microsoft. I want to see what he dreamt of. Roll the video.
And that really opened up a whole new world of opportunities. I joined Microsoft 10 years ago as a software engineer. I love making things which improve people's lives. And one of the things I've always dreamt of since I was at university was this idea of something that could tell you at any moment what's going on around you.
I think it's a man jumping in the air doing a trick on a skateboard.
All right, I really hope you get inspired to build apps that can be socially useful and improve this world a little better. If you want to get started, cognitive services in Azure, face recognition, text-to-speech are just some of the few that are available. And if you are after the HoloLens device, programming HoloLens as well. So thank you very much. Social coordinates on screen. If you want to get in touch, any follow-up questions, please feel free to do so. And any questions for me right now?
Thank you, Stefano. And I think it's great how when we have optimizations and enhancements in the different services, they kind of improve the other services. So when there's enhancements in text, cognitive services, then vision also has additional capabilities. So I really enjoy working in the ecosystem. We do have a question from the viewer, and one of the concerns that we have as a society is some of these tools are allowing us to take objects and people in and out of images, as well as recreate voices and emulate people. So you know, we've seen with deep fakes that this can create a lot of disinformation. So what are your thoughts on how Microsoft is going about addressing some of those issues?
There is a big problem in AI that data scientists will agree with, is on removing bias from models. Unfortunately, there is no simple solution except try to be more as ethical and fair as possible in creating, in training models that are as inclusive as possible. That, for example, you can think face recognition can be when detecting emotions, when detecting age, when detecting gender, is obviously biased towards the stereotype of a male and a female. And we know the world is not just binary. So there is obviously an exercise, an effort that has to be made in trained models to remove this bias and improve the accuracy. There is no solution except doing hard work on classifying different images and improve this level of detection as much as possible. It's probably not possible to remove bias at all, simply because we as people, when we classify the images, so we are also sort of driven by bias ourselves. But leveraging the power of open communities, the power of mass crowd intelligence, it is possible to remove this over and over time. Very briefly, I have made an experience some time ago in skin condition detection. So recognizing some conditions on your face, whether it's wrinkles, acne, crown feet, and then there is a commercial application that I'm not going to go into it over recommending some product to address this concern. And obviously, that will work really well on white middle-aged women because the model was trained to the target market. Anybody else that doesn't fit into this category then wouldn't be recognized that easily. And that is a problem because, it was a commercial choice to target that audience. But in general, it's an audience when you offer public services, like the Azure Cognitive Services, you want to remove bias as much as possible to make it fair and more inclusive.
There's also the use of domains in computer vision. So do you feel that, as more people use these services and, you mentioned open source, that there will be kind of a proliferation of domain type data subsets that people start sharing in the open source community?
Yes, very good question and very big hope in this. There is already a sort of concept of domain of skills in the conversational AI, which addresses specifically chatbots and sort, especially in the customer service. You don't want to build, you cannot build a chatbot that is able to have any sort of conversation whatsoever, from a football result to a data scientist conversation. You want to have something that is specific, tailored to the domain, optimized. The same is for computer vision. It will very likely focus on a specific domain, skill your computer vision AI to detect one sort of object over the other one. Before, when Sadia was speaking, there was a question: can the device identify registration numbers, registration plate for cars in all the countries in the world? You don't need that because you're not using that camera, that one single camera in every country in the world, unlikely. So optimize for the US, optimize for the UK, optimize for Italy, optimize for Australia. The same device, but trained to different models so that is optimized to detect the registration plate in this country. Improve accuracy, reduce the training effort, and get better results at the end.
And I guess it works better on the HoloLens in that case, because you need less space, less compute power to actually predict what's on the license plate.
Especially when running at the edge, you're absolutely right. At the edge is not like the cloud where you can allocate a terabyte and terabyte of storage. You need to work on compressed compact models. So anything that you can save from a space and computing perspective will improve the performance of the device. Absolutely.
Cool. Well, thank you very much. We're out of time, sadly.
Sure.
I know for a fact that the HoloLens is a very interesting topic on its own. So if people are interested, they can probably...
chat anyway. So if people have questions, I'll stay on top of the chat and answer now.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stefano.
Alicia, what do you think? Shall we do a bit of VR this time? We've talked about AI.